Okay, so we shall begin with the next chapter under the CNS, that is CNS stimulants. Coming to the outline of the chapter, we'll see the definition of CNS stimulants. What exactly do you mean by the term? Then the classification of drugs which are used as CNS stimulants. Then comes the individual drugs. Okay, individual drugs under, there are three main classes into which the drugs are divided into. So we'll see the individual drugs under convulsants, then the drugs which are used as analeptics or respiratory stimulants, and psychostimulants. Now coming to the first part, that is the definition of CNS stimulants. What do you mean by the term CNS stimulants? So CNS stimulants are the drugs whose primary action is to stimulate the CNS globally. Okay, so these drugs will stimulate the CNS, entire CNS will be stimulated, okay, or to improve specific brain function. So either they will stimulate the CNS globally, or it will result in improvement of certain brain functions, like say for example memory may be affected, okay, or concentration may be affected, so that those kind of functions, specific brain functions may also be improved by certain agents. Okay, so these CNS stimulants, so they produce mostly a generalized action. Okay, now because of this generalized action onto your CNS at higher doses, this may also result into convulsions. Okay, so those drugs which have CNS stimulant property in higher doses, these may also result into convulsions. Okay, so epileptic seizures, epileptic attacks, similar to your pathophysiology or your epileptic attacks may be precipitated. Okay, no, actual pathophysiology does not exist over here. Okay, but because of the action of these drugs, because of the CNS stimulant action, they result in the convulsions also. So similar to your normal convulsions which are seen in the epileptic patients. Then coming to the classification, as I've told you earlier, these are mainly divided into three classes. The first one is the convulsants. Okay, so the name say implies what they are going to produce. Okay, so convulsants meaning something which will result in convulsions or precipitate the convulsions, similar to your normally seen epileptic attacks in the patients. Okay, so convulsants examples include strychnine, then picrodoxin, bicuculin, pentylin tetrazole, this is the accepted abbreviation PTZ. Okay, then the second class is analeptics or respiratory stimulants, example is doxapram. Then the third class is psychostimulants, examples included under this are amphetamines, methylphenidate, atomoxetine, modafinil, armodafinil, pemolin, cocaine and caffeine. Okay, this term must be familiar to you all, it's a local anesthetic. Right, cocaine, so it is having CNS stimulant property also. We have seen that it is the most prominent drug which shows the CNS stimulant action. Okay, so cocaine also acts as a CNS stimulant drug. Okay, now these are the drugs which we have listed under specific classes. Now apart from this, there are many other drugs which may be acting on the CNS. Okay, so either they will produce CNS stimulation as a side effect, or at higher doses it may result in the CNS stimulation. Okay, so mind it, there are many other drugs which have the CNS stimulant property which are not listed over here. So they may produce that CNS stimulation as a side effect, or they may stimulate the CNS specifically at the higher doses or at the toxic doses. Now coming to the first class, that is convulsants. Under this, the first drug is strychnine. Now strychnine, I'm sure you all must have studied under Cognosy or will be studying in your Cognosy. Okay, so strychnine, it is a naturally obtained substance. It is a naturally occurring alkaloid which is obtained from the seeds of Strychnus nux vomica. This is the source from which this compound is obtained. So it's a naturally occurring alkaloid and is a very potent convulsant. So upon administration of this strychnine alkaloid, it will result in precipitation of the convulsions, and these convulsions are reflex, tonic, clonic and symmetrical type of convulsions which are precipitate. Now this drug strychnine, it is known as a spinal convulsant. Now what do you mean by this spinal convulsant? Okay, so basically this site may be in the spinal cord, or if you can see that this study was carried out wherein this same amount of drug, okay, it was administered to spinal animals. Okay, now spinal animals are the animals from whom the or from whose spinal cord is detached from the brain. Okay, so the brain may be removed, like say for example in case of frogs, if you detach the brain of these frogs from the spinal cord, still you will find that the animal is alive. Okay, so this these are known as the spinal animals, okay, in whom you detach the brain or remove the brain. And intact animals are those who have their brain and spinal cord connected and intact. Okay, so if you can see that this agent, the same dose of this strychnine, it produces the convulsions. Okay, so same type of convulsions are produced in both type of animals. So it indicates that the site could be in the spinal cord. Okay, but actually it is seen that it stimulates the whole cerebrospinal axis. That is the brain as well as the spinal cord is being stimulated by this strychnine. Okay, now coming to the mechanism of action of the strychnine, how it results in the convulsions or CNS stimulant action, how it is being produced. Okay, so basically the strychnine, it acts by blocking the postsynaptic inhibition which is produced by inhibitory transmitter glycine. Okay, so glycine, just like your GABA, we know that there are certain excitatory neurotransmitters, certain inhibitory neurotransmitters. So glycine, GABA, these are the inhibitory type of transmitters. Okay, so when they are released, they will result in the inhibition in your neurons, okay, wherever it is released. So this glycine, normally when it is released as a neurotransmitter, it results in postsynaptic inhibition. Okay, you understand what is the meaning of postsynaptic? Okay, something beyond or further to your synapse. Okay, so wherever it is released, in the postsynaptic region, it will result in the inhibition. Okay, so inhibition is the action which is produced by this glycine. It's an inhibitory transmitter. Now what strychnine is doing, it is blocking this, blocking the action of your glycine. Okay, so glycine, which produces postsynaptic inhibition, it is blocked by strychnine. Now because it blocks the action of your glycine to produce postsynaptic inhibition, so what will happen ultimately when strychnine is given? Will the inhibition be seen? No, the opposite action will be produced, that is excitation will be seen under the influence of strychnine, because it is having or it is blocking the action of your glycine, which is a inhibitory transmitter. So on a contrary, excitation or CNS stimulation will be seen when strychnine is administered. The site of action of this strychnine is found to be Renshaw cell motor neuron junction. This is located in your spinal cord, okay, through which actually these inhibitory signals are being transmitted. Now what strychnine is doing, it is blocking the action of your glycine. So all these synaptic inhibition which keeps your neurons inhibited, that is lost. So if whenever there is any kind of nerve impulse coming to this region, okay, it will become generalized and it will result in apparent excitation and convulsions are precipitated. Okay, so if you can see, will it be of any use therapeutically because it is producing convulsions? Will it be used? Do you want to precipitate convulsions in any individuals? No. You are finding for treatment of convulsions, right? Under anti-epileptic chapter we have seen, we have to look out for the treatment of convulsions. But what these are doing, they are precipitating convulsions. So this is only of toxicological importance. Okay, strychnine does not have any valid therapeutic use. It is only of toxicological importance. That is, accidentally if someone consumes Nux vomica seeds, say specifically mostly may happen with the children because they do not know what to consume, what not to consume. So accidental consumption by small children, it may result in poisoning with this alkaloid which is found in that Nux vomica. So you need to treat the adverse effects which may be precipitated or the symptoms which may be precipitated due to strychnine poisoning. So treatment, it is similar to that of treatment of status epilepticus. Okay, under anti-epileptic chapters we have seen the treatment of status epilepticus. Okay, phenobarbital is generally preferred for the treatment of status epilepticus. Okay, this is a emergency situation wherein the brain is under the constant or persistent convulsions. Okay, so similar kind of treatment have to be given because the convulsions may be similar type of convulsions may be precipitated in case of poisoning with strychnine. Okay, so strychnine, no doubt it is of only of poison toxicological importance, but still strychnine is used as a laboratory tool also to induce convulsions in the animals, to you know, to develop the models to test the anticonvulsant drug. Okay, you will be studying in this in your practicals also of final year. Okay, so it is a laboratory tool. Okay, we have seen that it can precipitate the convulsions, so it is used as a laboratory tool to induce the convulsions in the animals so that you can test your drug for anticonvulsant property. How you will test a drug whether it is having anticonvulsant property or no? So for that you have to produce or induce the convulsions in certain animals, right? Before giving that or after giving that drug, you need to induce the convulsions. So for that purpose, certain chemicals are used to induce those convulsions so that you can test the anticonvulsant agent. So strychnine is one of the agent which is used to precipitate the convulsions. So it is one of the model. Okay, coming to the next drug, that is picrotoxin. So this is also a naturally obtained substance. It is obtained from the fish berries of Anamirtha coculus. This is the source from which it is obtained. This is again a potent convulsant, produces convulsions which are clonic, spontaneous and asymmetrical. So the spread is asymmetrical in both your hemispheres, and along with convulsions it also precipitates vomiting, respiratory and vasomotor stimulation. Now coming to the mechanism of action of picrotoxin. Now picrotoxin, it acts by blocking the presynaptic inhibition which is mediated by GABA. Okay, so we have seen that strychnine, it acts by blocking the postsynaptic inhibition which is mediated by glycine. Now here picrotoxin, it is acting by blocking the presynaptic inhibition which is mediated through GABA. So normally we are already aware that GABA is an inhibitory transmitter. GABA, how it acts on the GABA receptor, GABA A receptor, which is a chloride channel. So it opens the chloride channel, so chloride ions will flow through and it will result in presynaptic inhibition. Okay, so now how picrotoxin is acting? It is acting by blocking this particular inhibition. So picrotoxin, it, as such, it does not bind to the GABA receptor. Okay, its site, it's not a competitive antagonist. It will not go and bind to GABA receptor, okay, on your chloride channel. But it itself has its distinct site on this chloride channel. So it will bind to that site and it will, what it will do? It will prevent the chloride channel opening. So it will prevent this. Chloride ion channels will not open, which actually happens with the action of your GABA. So it is opposing the action of GABA. Chloride ion channels will not open, and that's how this presynaptic inhibition is blocked. Okay, so it will result in the opposite action, that is excitation will be seen. Now this picrotoxin is also not having any therapeutic indication. Okay, so it is also of toxicological importance. It is also used to induce the convulsions in the animals, and in case of toxicity takes place. Okay, because it's a naturally obtained substance, so accidental consumption may result in the convulsions, precipitation of the convulsions. So how can you treat this? Diazepam. Okay, so diazepam or BZDs. Okay, BZDs, how they act? They act by facilitating the GABA transmission. What has happened to your GABA transmission over here? It is being blocked by picrotoxin. So you want some drug which will promote the action of GABA. Okay, so diazepam or benzodiazepines, we have seen that they have GABA facilitatory action. That is, they promote this GABA transmission. They promote the GABA binding to its receptor on the chloride channel. So it will open the chloride channel and it will result in this inhibition. So it will help in controlling this excitation or the convulsions which are precipitated by picrotoxin. Then coming to the next drug, that is bicuculin. This is again a convulsant drug, but it's a synthetic convulsant. Okay, so far the two examples which we have seen, okay, strychnine and picrotoxin, those are naturally obtained substances, but this one is the synthetic convulsant having action similar to that of picrotoxin like action, but here the mechanism is slightly different. Okay, produce the similar action. Okay, but in case of picrotoxin, we have seen that picrotoxin does not bind to the GABA receptor. It binds maybe somewhere over here on some other subunit of your chloride channel, contains the picrotoxin binding site, and that's how it results in the inhibition of the action of your GABA. But that is not the case with bicuculin. How it acts? It acts as a competitive GABA A receptor antagonist. So what it will do? It will compete with your GABA to bind to its receptor. And it once this bicuculin binds to this GABA receptor itself over here, it will block the receptor. So because of this blockage of this receptor, what will happen? GABA will not be able to bind here because it's a competitive inhibitor, competitive blocker. That means in presence of GABA, there will be competition between GABA and bicuculin for the same site, for the same receptor. Bicuculin will bind to this receptor, prevent GABA from binding to this receptor. So as a result, what will happen? GABA is not able to bind to its receptor. What will happen to your chloride channel? Will it open? No, it will not open because this receptor has been blocked. GABA is not able to bind to its receptor, and it's an antagonist. Bicuculin is an antagonist. It cannot stimulate this receptor. So what will happen? This opening of chloride channel is inhibited, and that's how it is blocking this inhibition produced by the GABA. Again, this drug also does not have any therapeutic usage, and it is also used as a research tool, that is to induce the convulsions in the animals for testing the anticonvulsant agents. Then the next agent under this is pentylene tetrazole. It is accepted short form PTZ, it is called. Another name for this is metrazole, or it is also known as leptazole. This is again a powerful CNS stimulant agent. Okay, which is acting by a slightly different mechanism. It is producing direct depolarization of the central neurons. Okay, so this is the main mechanism of action of pentylene tetrazole. In your CNS, globally it will result in the depolarization of the neurons in your brain. Okay, apart from this, is the main mechanism. Apart from this, it is also acting by interfering with the GABAergic inhibition. That is, it will block the action or the inhibition which is produced through GABA. That is also blocked, similar to that of picrotoxin. So both the mechanisms are true. Either directly it will result in depolarization of the neurons. So depolarization meaning action potential will get generated and the neurons will get stimulated, and it will result in excitatory actions or CNS stimulant action, or convulsions may be precipitated. Apart from this, it can act through GABA also. Okay, similar to that of the picrotoxin. So GABAergic transmission is affected, and that's how it is resulting in excitation. Now, depending upon the dose which is used, variable actions are seen. In lower doses, it merely produces the excitation, whereas if you go at higher doses, larger doses mainly will precipitate the convulsions. Okay, similar to that of your picrotoxin, but higher doses are required. However, the margin of safety is, you know, not very much good. Okay, that is, even the certain conventional doses may also precipitate the convulsions. Okay, so again, this drug is also of no clinical use. It is again used as a laboratory tool to induce the convulsions for testing of the anticonvulsant drugs in the laboratory animals. Okay, coming to the second class under this chapter, that is analeptics, or it is also known as respiratory stimulants. Okay, so these drugs, as the name implies, these are the drugs which will stimulate the respiration. Okay, so your respiration, your ventilation rate will be stimulated by these drugs. Okay, and these can have a resuscitative value in coma and fainting. That means if a person has gone into coma or if the person has fainted, you can recover that person from coma or from fainting. Okay, the person falls unconscious, so you can bring that person back to consciousness. So it has that property also. Okay, though it in the subconvulsive doses, that is in the lower doses, it can stimulate only the respiration, still again here the margin of safety is narrow. That is, it can precipitate the convulsions in a person who is still in coma. The person is still in coma, but convulsions may be precipitated in such individuals also. So margin of safety is not very good, so you should go for more safer techniques, like say mechanical support to your respiration. If the person is not able to breathe appropriately, you can give the mechanical support, or ventilators are preferred over here. Okay, so that it can improve the respiration and the circulation of that person. So as we have seen that the margin of safety is not very good, the use of these agent therapeutically is very limited. No doubt it is used in certain, can be used in certain situations, and again one statement is made, again the utility in all these conditions is also dubious, that is, it is doubtful. Okay, so let us see which are the situations in which you can use these drugs as an expedient measure in hypnotic drug poisoning. Okay, expedient measure meaning time being measured in case of hypnotic drug poisoning. Say for example, barbiturates, we have seen that it can depress the respiration, right? Respiratory depressant it is. Okay, so for time being, until mechanical ventilation is instituted, for time being you can give this analeptic agents also. As far as possible it should be avoided. Mechanical ventilation has to be opted for. Then the next use could be suffocation on drowning. If the person has drowned into water, say swimming pool or say in the river, okay, wherein water must have entered into your respiratory tracts. Okay, so there may be suffocation which is produced. So to stimulate the respiration in such conditions also it could be used. Then acute respiratory insufficiency, wherein there is high level of carbon dioxide in your body. Okay, or low oxygen level. So in that case, if you stimulate the respiration, it will help in removal of your carbon dioxide, increase amount of carbon dioxide in your body. The next use could be apnea in the premature infant. Premature meaning the baby which is born before completion of the 9 months. So they may suffer from apnea, that is the shortening of breathing, cessation of the breathing, stoppage of breathing may take place. Okay, so they may have breathing difficulties. So for that also it could be preferred, okay, to stimulate the respiration. Then another use is failure to ventilate spontaneously, meaning those who are on general anesthetic for a longer period of time, they in the general anesthesia also we have seen the complication could be respiratory depression. We have seen in deeper stages that respiration is severely getting affected, specifically the thoracic one is getting affected. Cessation of the breathing may also take place. Okay, so in such individuals who fail to ventilate spontaneously, meaning on their own, if they fail to breathe appropriately, okay, so in such individuals also analeptic drugs or respiratory stimulants can be given. However, still it is doubtful. It is better to give a ventilatory support, mechanical ventilation, to such individuals. There is only one drug under this particular class, that is doxapram, which is found to be relatively safer. Okay, so this drug acts by promoting the excitation of the central neuron. So direct stimulation of the or depolarization of the central neurons is how it acts. And this doxapram, it is, you know, in lower doses, when it is used in the lower doses, it is more selective towards the respiratory center rather than other analeptics. Okay, so if you can compare, this doxapram is quite safer because it is producing selective action on your respiratory center. It is stimulating your respiratory centers selectively. Okay, we do not want generalized CNS stimulation over here. We want respiratory center to be stimulated, because of which the respiration or your ventilatory rate will be improved. Okay, so that's how it acts. It acts by excitation of the neurons specifically in the respiratory center when it is used in the lower dose. So this is how it acts, the mechanism of action. Apart from that, also the respiration is stimulated through carotid and aortic body chemoreceptors. Okay, now what are these carotid and aortic body chemoreceptors? These are generally found in your blood vessels. These are chemoreceptors, meaning they are continuously monitoring the levels of your carbon dioxide and oxygen in your blood. Okay, so what happens whenever there is increase in carbon dioxide, whenever there is drop in the oxygen level in your blood, it is detected by these. There are baroreceptors and there are chemoreceptors. Baroreceptors are dealing with the stretch. Okay, those are stretch receptors. So they will modulate the, or they will monitor the, how much stretching is taking place. So that's how they will control the BP. Okay, but here what they are monitoring, these receptors, these chemoreceptors, they are monitoring the chemical level, that is your carbon dioxide and oxygen level. So if there is any increase in the carbon dioxide level or if there is any drop in oxygen level, these receptors will get stimulated. They will send the signal to your respiratory center and it will stimulate it. So that's how your respiration will get increased, the rate of respiration will be increased and carbon dioxide will be removed out and more oxygen will be taken in. That's how they function. So doxapram is found to act through stimulating these receptors, chemoreceptors also. Okay. Apart from that, it also affects your BP. Falling BP may rise, it may produce rise in BP also. And another use of this doxapram is in the controlling the apnea. Continuous IV infusion is given of this drug. Okay, so it will abolish the episodes of apnea in the premature infants. That's what we have seen. It could be used, one of the purpose of this drug is to control the apnea, that is the shortening of the breathing in the premature infants. Okay, so infants, those babies which are born before the term, they may have difficulties in breathing. Okay, they may not be able to breathe on their own, so ventilators have to be provided in certain cases. Okay, so IV infusion of this doxapram also is helpful if this infant is not responding to theophylline. Theophylline is actually used. Okay, it's a supportive measure for apnea. Okay, but if theophylline is not found to be useful, then you can switch over to IV infusion of doxapram. Okay, so as an alternative, you can use doxapram in case of infants. Okay, we shall stop here.